So it's time to start. Hello and welcome to this talk. My name is Thomas Huth, and I'm telling to you today something about KVM on Power. I'm a software engineer at Red Hat and working there in a virtualization team and taking there from KVM on Power. So I thought it would be a good topic for a talk. So what I'm going to tell you today is a short introduction into the Power architecture and the Power platforms, and then we have a close look at KVM and QEMU on Power directly. And at the end, I want to talk a little bit about something that is special on this architecture too. That's the partition firmware, or the boot firmware that is used to boot the guests on the virtual machines. So let's start with a short introduction of the Power architecture and platforms. What is Power in this case here? I mean, Power is of course a word that this has many meanings, but in this case, it's a family of RISC CPUs, and it's an abbreviation for performance optimization with enhanced RISC. It was originally introduced by IBM in the early 1990s with their Power 1 server processor. And IBM continued to develop this processor line for their servers till Power 8, which was released, I think, 2 years ago in 2014. Beside that, there's also the term Power PC. You maybe know that. Power PC was a joint venture of a was introduced by a joint venture of a couple of firms in the 1990s. IBM, Motorola, and Apple, they teamed up to build Power compatible processors that were suitable for desktop PCs too. And later also Motorola and later Freescale also used this term for releasing embedded chips that were compatible with the Power instruction set. However, the Power PC name is not officially used anymore by these companies, so it has officially abandoned, I think, maybe 10 years ago or something like that. And but you still see this name in a couple of software projects. For example, in the Linux kernel, the architecture is still called Power PC, and in the QEMU sources, you see the abbreviation for Power PC called PPC. So the naming can be a little bit confusing. You have Power with capital letters. That's normally meant to be the server chips by IBM. Power with one capital letter and the rest small is normally meant to be the Power architecture or the Power family in general. And there are these legacy terms, PPC and Power PC, which normally nowadays, if they are still used, also mean just referring to the whole family of Power chips. At that point in time, let me ask a question. Whoever here in the audience worked with a Power-based system before? Oh, that's a lot. Okay, whoever of you was using here the Open Power Hub in Brno? Okay, that's not that much. So if you are interested, here's an Open Power lab in Brno. You can get virtual machines on, so if you want to experiment a little bit, that's a good place to start. So what makes the Power architecture special? So you have, generally speaking, two different flavors of the chips. There are the server chips, many manufactured by IBM, and there are embedded power chips you can maybe have in your dishwasher or in your mobile phone or something like that, which are often manufactured by Freescale and other companies.
Where you will put G4 and G5, they were used in desktop?
It was Apple who used the desktops, and this were the last Power PC chips. So they were in between, I would say.
Yeah.
So if you're really interested, I've got a nice picture at the end.
Friends were still using Power PC machines, but they are just weird.
Yeah. So here you can more or less see the evolution of the instruction set architecture and the server line by IBM. And then it was the desktop line, which later influenced the book E as the embedded line. And someone in 2006, people said, oh, it's got too diverse, we've got to unify again. And since 2006, there's at least only one instruction set architecture specification. So it got a little bit merged again, but within the instruction set architecture specification, there are two books, book 3S and book 3E. So that's still a difference between the servers and the embedded chips. Beside the server and the embedded flavors, you can have 32-bit or 64-bit machines, where the 64-bit machines, the instruction set is a superset of the 32-bit instruction set. That means, unless like in ARM, as far as I know, where they completely reinvented the instruction set for 64-bit, the 32-bit instructions are still valid in 64-bit mode. And interesting thing is that you can have some of the chips can run in big or in little endian mode. And traditionally, big endian is more common, but this is also changing nowadays. For example, with the new Power8 server CPUs, you can switch them to a little endian mode too. And since our last RHEL release, we've got also no support for little endian in the RHEL kernel. Platforms. So this was the Power architecture only talks about the CPUs themselves. So everything that is around the CPU defines the platform. So this is the other hardware that can be found, like source bridges or onboard devices, and of course also only the firmware interfaces which are used for booting the machines. And on Power platforms, each platform mostly often looks completely different than the others. So for example, the Apple Power Max had completely different interface than IBM servers or the embedded chips. For example, the embedded chips are often system on a chip where everything is in one chip, even the thing that you normally find on a South Bridge or network devices or stuff like that. Yeah, we will talk later about firmware interfaces. So this graphics shows you a little bit this variety. So in the x86 world, you basically have one kind of machine, a standard PC, you could say. Of course, there are some differences. You can have different chipsets, different source bridges. But more or less, the programming model for the operating system looks everywhere the same. So okay, nowadays you also got UEFI beside BIOS for booting, but the machines look very similar. While in the Power world, every machine can look very different. So for example, the PlayStation was also one Power PC-based machine, which looked completely different than an embedded Power PC that you used in your dishwasher, for example. And there are two platforms I want to talk a little bit more about, and this is the so-called Pepper platform and the Power NVENC platform. And I start with the Pepper platform, sometimes also called S-Pepper for server Pepper, to distinguish from the E-Pepper, which is the embedded Pepper. Pepper means Power Architecture Platform Reference, and to understand this, you've got to know that the IBM servers ship with a standard hypervisor since Power 4 already. So your operating system on these machines is normally not running bare metal, but within a virtual machine and a logical partition in the wording of IBM. And this logical partition environment is defined by this this Pepper specification. So Pepper defines a set of virtual devices like a virtual network interface, a virtual SCSI interface, virtualized access to the memory management unit, and virtualized access to the PCI host bridge. It defines an environment for booting or a firmware interface. In this case, it's open firmware. I'll speak a little bit more about open firmware at a later slide. And also a runtime interface for the operating system. So this is a set of hypercalls, something called RTAS, which means runtime abstraction services. Why am I you telling this? This is good to know because QEMU mimics this Pepper environment with the so-called P-series machine. So QEMU, and in this case also then KVM, of course, mimics this standard hypervisor that is normally shipped with IBM server processors. Now you might wonder, if these server machines ship with a hypervisor, how can I use KVM on these? Because KVM is also a hypervisor. Well, here comes the PowerNV platform. This is a new offering by IBM that are the machines that are shipped without this standard hypervisor. So on these machines, the Linux kernel can run on the bare metal. And of course, KVM is part of the Linux kernel, so in this case, you can use KVM on these machines too. And of course, they also come with their own firmware interface. So in this case, it's called Opal. So if you ever see that term, it's the firmware interface of the PowerNV platform. But I'm not going into details here. Okay, now we've got our machine. Now we can run KVM on Power. Just to recap a little bit for those who are not that familiar with the terms, KVM is the kernel-based virtual machine. It's the virtualization infrastructure in the Linux kernel. It's a kernel module which provides access to the virtualization features of the host CPU. Of course, alone, if you just have a kernel module, you cannot do anything as a normal user with it. So you need a user space application which uses these interfaces, and this is normally QEMU, the Quick Emulator, and since KVM is only taking care of the virtualized CPU, everything else, that means I/O emulation, is normally done in the QEMU emulator, so virtual disk, virtual network, stuff like that. On top of this, you normally have some kind of management layer like libvirt, virsh, virtmanager, ovirt. However, this is not part of this talk. I just wanted to mention it here for completeness. So, speaking about the KVM kernel module, as a normal user, you do not have to know that much about it because you normally do not work with it directly. There's only one thing I wanted to mention is that on Power, we have actually two different KVM kernel modules. The first one is the so-called KVM HV kernel module, and HV stands for hypervisor mode. This is a bit in the machine state register, which tells the CPU that it's now running in hypervisor mode. And this kernel module takes advantage of the virtualization features of the host CPU, so it's only working on CPUs that support this feature, for example, the latest PowerI chips from IBM. And because it's using these hardware features, the virtual machines can run there very fast. But it has the disadvantage, for example, that you can only run a guest CPU, a CPU type in the guest that is very similar to the CPU type in the host. So, for example, you can use a PowerI guest CPU on a Power 8 host, and I think it's also possible to use a Power 7 CPU on a Power 8 host with some compatibility features. The other kernel module is the so-called KVM PR kernel module, where PR stands for the so-called problem state bit in the machine state register, and this bit says that the CPU is running in user mode. So how this works is that the virtual machine is actually run in user mode. So the KVM module switches to user mode. And as long as you only run user mode instructions in your virtual machine, they can be executed directly. Now, if you run a privileged instruction, a kernel mode instruction in the guest, then the virtual machine is exited, and this privileged instruction is emulated in the host, either in a kernel module or in QEMU. So this is, of course, a little bit slower if your guest is using a lot of privileged instructions, but it has the big advantage that this kernel module more or less runs on every kind of host CPU. And because of because the user mode instructions are more or less similar on all power architecture CPUs, you can even run different guest CPUs on your host. So for example, you could run an embedded guest CPU type on a server CPU host. It, of course, has some restrictions. You cannot run a 64-bit guest on a 32-bit host CPU, but apart from that, it's much more flexible. And it has the nice advantage that you can use it for nested emulation. So you cannot use the KVM HV kernel module for nested emulation, but if you want to run a guest in a guest on a host, then you can use the KVM PR kernel module. So that's all I wanted to say about KVM. Looking at Q, is there a question?
Yeah, what about NDNS? Can you mix it in the emulated environment?
Sorry, what was?
Can you run, for example, big NDN host and emulate a little NDN guest on that?
You can, yeah.
Wow.
Actually, I'm not sure about the KVM PR kernel module, but you can, with the KVM HV kernel module, you can run a little NDN guests on big Indian hosts and vice versa.
Nice, thank you.
Yeah. So looking at QEMU, because of the variety, big variety that you've seen already, it also supports quite a big number of CPU types and also a big number of machine types, or in my previous wording, platform types. If you want to run a normal server VM on a server host, you should, of course, use enable KVM and always use CPU host and machine P series. Now, the good thing is if you use enable KVM, CPU host is the default and machine P series is also the default, so you can simply also omit the last two parameters and you also get what you want normally. Something that is different from the x86 world is that you also get a set of devices that are specific to this Pepper platform. So as I said earlier, in this Pepper standard defines how a para-virtualized network interface and a para-virtualized SCSI interface should look like. So QEMU offers these devices here too. And it's important to know that if you run QEMU without special parameters, or if you use, for example, the convenience option -HDA, you get one of these devices here, so the Pepper devices. And that's good because older guests that do not support WordIO yet normally support the Pepper standard, so they immediately can work with these devices. However, since the Pepper standard has not been designed with Linux in mind, and since these devices did not get that much attention as the WordIO devices yet, if you really want to have performance, you should rather use WordIO Net and WordIO Block and WordIO SCSI devices instead, if possible, if you create new virtual machines. Everybody knows what WordIO is? Anybody who does not know? Okay, great. So if you are a little bit familiar with KVM on PowerReady, this is a slide for you. This is what has been changed within the last year, what's new. So we had a lot of cross-engineness fixes. It should now be working pretty well to run a little Enyan guest on a big Enyan host and a big Enyan guest on a little Enyan host. We've got a new feature called dynamic micro-threading, or it's also called dynamic split core. These Power 8 chips are 8-way hyper-threaded. So each core has 8 hyper-threads. And this dynamic micro-threading uses these hyper-threading in a little bit better way, so that you can, for example, if your guest does not use hyper-threading but has 8 real cores, the scheduler can use one host core with the 8 hyper-threads to run them at once. We've got now hot plugging of PCI devices and memory. It's partly still work in progress, but the basics are there. And we've got a set of new hypercalls. For example, the edge random hypercall, which allows you to pass high quality random number data to the guest, so that the guest has a good source for random numbers too. It's an alternative interface to what you also get with Virt.io RNG, if you know that. So we've had a look at KVM, we've had a look at QMU, now I want to show you another difference to the x86 world, and this is the firmware or the BIOS that is used in a virtual machine to boot the operating system. In this case here, it's a firmware called Sloth, and that's an implementation of the so-called open firmware standard. And this is used because this PEPA specification mandates this open firmware standard. Open firmware was originally a standard introduced for the Sun Spark machines, later also adapted to PowerPC and ARM, and I think there was even a version for x86 used for one laptop per child. It was an IEEE standard in the 1990s. However, that standard did not get extended, so it's considered as abandoned nowadays. And it's based on the fourth programming language. And you might wonder why fourth. It's a stack-based language, and it has the big advantage that you can do an interpreter with a very small footprint. So you could put a whole interpreter into a small ROM, which was important in the 1990s. And have you already been to the IT museum here? I can recommend it. There's one 8-bit machine which has a force interpreter built in as interface too. So it made me smile. So QMU now uses this open firmware interface and uses the Sloth firmware, which has originally been developed as alternative firmware from some of the IBM servers and later been open sourced for the TerraSoft Power Station in 2008. So the Power Station was a last attempt to continue with desktop PowerPC machines after Apple said, oh, we are doing now x86 instead. However, that was never really successful, but at least the open firmware has been open sourced. The firmware has been open sourced for this computer. So when a firmware was needed for QMU, for the P-series machine QMUs, this open source release has been adapted to run in the partition of QMU instead. Some features of this firmware, it's supporting more or less all typical devices. You get VGA support, you get USB support, even HCI support it has already. Typical block devices, CASI, Virt.io block are available. And one nice thing is that you can even get support for some file systems. So it has support for FAT, extended 2, for example. So if you want to boot a file from your USB stick that you plugged in, you can do it immediately without an additional bootloader magic. Of course, it also allows you to boot from via network. So it supports the typical network devices with IONET and also the Pepper network interface. And beside the normal IP version 4 support, there's also IP version 6 support almost there. There are some few things still left to be done, but should be doable in this year, I think. So when you start your partition, or your guest, your VM, the first output that you normally see is something like this here. And the interesting thing is here, it says press S to enter open firmware, and then you end up at the slough or open firmware prompt. And now I want to show you a little bit what you can do here. I'm trying to do it live. I hope it will work. F11. Ah, nice. Is it big enough? Can you read it also from the back? Okay, great. So it says press S, so I should do that. And so now the firmware is currently booting up. It's terribly slow here because it's running on my laptop in emulated mode, so it's running without KVM. And of course, if you run it on a real machine, it just goes floop, and you have to be really fast to press the S key before the operating system is booted. The firmware is written for most parts in fourth, and this gets interpreted during each boot. So this is also not as fast as a firmware that is completely written in C. But yeah, it's still usable in an emulator, so that's okay. So now here, do you see it? Okay, should be okay, I hope. So now we are at the firmware prompt, and now what can you do here? I mean, you probably have never been here before, so you can do everything what you could do with FOSS. So FOSS is a stack-based programming language, so I can say 3, and this puts a 3 on a stack. And as you can see here, it's a little bit hard to see. Maybe I go back. So I think that's a little bit better. So you can see here the prompt has changed, and the number here says how many items you've got on a stack. So now I have a 3 on the stack. I can put a 4 on this. Oops, 4 on the stack. And now I have 2 items on my stack. And if I want to see what's on the stack, I can use, for example, .s, and it prints out 3 and 4. I can use plus takes the two topmost stack items and adds them together and puts the result back on the stack. And now I've got, of course, only one item on the stack. And if I just use one point, that prints out the topmost stack item. So 3 plus 4 are 7, for example. Yeah, that's just the very basics of FOSS, so if you want to have a closer look, I can recommend some reading later. The more interesting parts are maybe analyzing the device tree, for example. So the device tree is a structure that tells the operating system later how the system should look like. For example, where can I access the PCI bus, which power virtualized devices are available, and stuff like that. So to have a look at the device tree, or to move around in the device tree, you use the dev command, and then you say at which node you want to go. For example, I go to the root node and say dev slash. And then there's ls, so it's a little bit like shell, so list. And it shows me how the device tree looks like. So you can see, for example, we've got a para virtualized SCSI interface here at this address. And there's currently, for example, only one CPU in this virtual machine. And now I could, for example, have a closer look at the properties of that CPU if I if I go to that node. And then there's the .properties command. Oh, by the way, we've got tab completion, so if you press tab twice, you get a list of supported commands. And there you go. So the CPU node, you can, for example, have a look at how big the caches are or what frequency it uses and stuff like this. So this is sometimes good for debugging your boot process if something is not working as expected. Now, if you're done with analyzing the system, the most interesting thing is, of course, to boot the system. And if you want to know where you can boot from, for example, if you do not want to boot from the default disk or from because the default installation has been corrupted, you want to boot from another disk, then it's good to know what devices are available. And for this, I recommend the so-called dev alias command. So this prints out a list of aliases to the device tree nodes. And the sloth firmware adds an alias for each device tree node, which it thinks it could boot. So for example, if I want to boot from the CD-ROM, I simply say boot CD-ROM. And it says load failed because the CD-ROM image I've added to my virtual machine does not contain a bootable CD-ROM. But this, I know that the CD-ROM image that I've added to my virtual machine contains a file which I could boot. So since Sloth now has support for the file systems, I can specify that file here and say, oh, how did I call it? I think it was test.fs. So this is a little for script. And yeah, it booted the for script and says, hello world. Thank you. So apart from that, there's also support for network booting. So if you configure a TFTP server, it gets the information from the TFTP server automatically. But you can also specify the parameters manually. So the first parameter, for example, is the TFTP server address. And then you say the file name. And then you say which should be the IP address of the client. So in this case, I'm using another one more. And it should also work, for example. Now it did use the point 16 address. So yeah, we finally booted our virtual machine, our virtual power system. And now everything is running. And that's pretty much it. Do we have any questions? I have some minutes left. It's always So the question is, what's the real advantage of using power hardware compared to Intel? I would say I'm not the right person to answer this question. Better go to a salesperson instead. If you want to have an unofficial answer from me, I would say there are a couple of advantages, like, for example, these power chips have a high-speed interface where you can attach GPUs onto. And there are certain workloads which are really running faster on power, as far as I know. So,
I can provide a little bit.
Do you want to have a microphone, maybe? How do we enable that?
The advantage of Power is that the threads in Power 8 performs quite much better than on the hyper threading Intel has. So there has been some, IBM did release some performance numbers where they had SMT zero, which means no threading at all, and you had a certain amount of performance out. Enabling SMT two, where it had two threads, it was a little bit up and up and up, and up to SMT eight, it was actually twice the performance as without. But that requires that the application is written completely for multi-threading, so it can actually benefit from it. And when it comes to virtualization, it's there are some unofficial reports I've heard from IBM where they actually put up a full-spec machine and started a new VM every second. And they stopped around 1,000 VMs. And so say it's in a production environment, you can run 200 VMs on a quite okay spec'd machine. You cannot do that with the same price range with Intel. So there's a benefit. And you mentioned the hardware interface. You have the copy interface, which is actually a way of kind of PCI over to an external device. IBM put up a, replaced a half a rack of Intel servers running a Redis database with four units. Two units were a Power PC, Power 8 machine, and the other two units were actually a disk array with SSD, 40 terabytes of SSDs. And they could actually, with this copy interface, get the performance that when they worked with the disk, it was like working with RAM, which meant that those four units replaced half rack for the Redis database, and they had better performance. So that's just a few vague indications. And if you go to DevConf, I think last year, Jeff Scheel, who is the chief architect for Power, Linux on Power, he had a presentation here where he actually told much more about these things.
Yeah, I think that presentation is online on YouTube. I've seen it. So. Yeah, you can write fast code. That's incredible, isn't it? So.
And I want a different question.
Yeah.
How is it better than a normal IBM translation? Like go.
You mean okay?
System where you have redundancy over the hardware.
Yeah, if you're happy with the normal IBM system, you can of course buy also that. This is. So this Power KVM or the KVM on Power stuff, you can also only run Linux clients, for example. You cannot run AIX on these machines yet. So this is, but these machines are of course also a little bit cheaper. So if you just are happy with Linux running on Power and you already have some knowledge with how to manage a KVM-based system, then these machines are the ones you want to have. But if you have traditional AIX workloads, then of course you need the traditional systems instead. So I'm repeating a little bit for those who watch it later online. So The Power KVM offering, to say it short, is also to attract some people who are used to 2D-inch machines, you could say, right? So the people who are used to KVM on Intel machines, so that they could easier be moved over, and yeah. So we're pretty much out of time. Last.
Okay. This is still development.
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's still supported. You can still buy it. Yeah. So I. Yeah. Okay, yeah, thank you. If you have more questions, here, mailing list. Somebody of you wants this car?
It's blue.
I've got two more. You want one?
1, 2, 3.